give you all the glory.
Show us our blessing. All the praises we can.
From where we are today, yes, we gotta say thank you, thank you, and Lord, and yes, you promised to deliver us.
One of the questions that is always on people's minds when we're dealing with the Bible, you speak to a lot of people, I speak to a lot of work colleagues, a lot of friends, family, and they will notice certain specific things about myself and about brothers who are following in the Spirit of Christ or are in the realms of the body of Christ Church. And questions get asked. Well, what are you, you know, who are you guys? And, you know, what is it that you're about? Well, we believe in God. We believe in Christ. We believe in the Bible. And we follow the commandments according to the scriptures. That's what we do. Because there's many things that we do, you know, pertaining to the Bible, believe it or not, that many groups, organizations, and churches say that they believe in God, they believe in Christ, they believe in the Bible. But when you present specific things to them, what's going on in the scriptures, it's like, wow, I didn't know that. So, for example, let's start with one of the basic questions. When dealing with someone who goes to church, dealing with someone that may be a Seventh-day Adventist or an Episcopalian or a Methodist or a Baptist or whatever the organization or the denomination may be, but they have a Bible. So one of the questions, you know, most of us within the body of Christ tend to do is, well, what was the beginning of Christ's ministry and what are we supposed to be doing according to the scriptures? So if there is anything that's supposed to be on people's minds, if there's any question, if there's any title that I would give this specific show that we're dealing with right now, it would be what? So what is the ordinances or the commandments or the beginning of Christ's teaching and his ministry? What was he teaching? What did he tell his disciples? Let's read it because it's in the Bible, and let's begin at Matthew 4:17. And let's see what it is that we're supposed to be doing.
Matthew 4:17. From that time, Jesus began to preach and to say, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand."
So the beginning stages of Christ's ministry, he began to preach and he began to teach. And he began to say, "Repent, because the kingdom of heaven is at hand." That's the first things that came out of Christ's mouth, is repentance. If we are going to be dealing with, we're going to be dealing with the Bible, we say we're following God, we say we're following Christ, we love the Lord, you know, we're doing what the Bible says, then repentance is the thing that's supposed to be on the forefront of our minds, what's going on in our minds and what we're supposed to do. Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. So the next question should be, well, what is repentance? How do you repent? What are the basic principles of repentance? The scriptures tell you in Proverbs, I think it's 28:13, mm-hmm. that for you to repent, you have to know what repentance is. So if you go to Proverbs 28:13, we're going to pick up some basic principles of how you can begin that process of what Christ was talking about. Repentance, okay?
Proverbs 28:13. He that covereth his sins shall not prosper.
So according to the Bible, it says a person that's covering their sins, you're not going to prosper. So if you're sinning against God, what's going to happen is you're not going to prosper spiritually. That's what he's talking about. He that covereth his sins shall not prosper. You're not going to grow. Go ahead.
But whoso confesseth and forsaketh them shall have mercy.
So whoever confesses their sins and whoever forsakes their sins shall have mercy. Read it again.
Proverbs 28, verse 13. He that covereth his sins shall not prosper.
He that covereth his sins shall not prosper. You're not going to prosper. You're not going to grow in the spirit of Christ. You're not going to get a spiritual understanding. You're not going to get any spiritual growth. Go ahead.
But whoso confesseth and forsaketh them shall have mercy.
Whoso confesseth and forsaketh them, them is the sins that we are committing against God. Whoever, if you're going to confess your sins, meaning you have to acknowledge what it is that you're doing against God and the commandments of the Bible. You have to recognize and realize, okay, this is a sin against God. That's a sin against God. That's confessing, and you have to make it known to yourself, look, okay, I'm eating pork. That's wrong. I'm not honoring thy father and thy mother. That's wrong. I need to stop doing that. You know? I'm not showing forth love towards my brother. I need to stop doing that. I'm not remembering the Sabbath day to keep it holy. I'm not doing that. I need to recognize that that's wrong. That's a sin against God. And guess what? I need to stop doing that. And I need to keep the Sabbath. Mm-hmm. So you're confessing. You're acknowledging that it's wrong. Humbling, that's part of humility. Humbling yourself to the Most High. Acknowledging that that's wrong. Not making excuses. Because that's what happens with a lot of us. Because of our lust, because we want to go out on, you find out that from Friday night sundown to Saturday night sundown, that's the Sabbath day. That's the day when the day starts at evening, from Friday to Saturday. And then what happens? Because that day is the most high profile day for shopping and going out. You've been doing this for so many years now. Now the understanding has come out that, no, this is wrong. That's a sin against God. You need to stop that. And that day has to be kept holy. And now all of a sudden it becomes a problem because it's your lust. It's our lust. And it becomes a fight. And these are the things that we need to know, how we're going to grow and get closer to God, how we're going to repent and get closer to the Most High. So just read that part again, and then we go back to Matthew. Go ahead.
But whoso confesseth and forsaketh them shall have mercy.
So the confession, and then the forsaking, and then the Lord is going to have mercy on you. Go to Romans 12 and 1.
Okay.
It's a process that we as individuals, men and women, have to go through to get closer to God in Christ, to get closer to the Most High. We have to acknowledge what we're doing against God, which is the wrong things that we're doing against the Most High in Christ, and repent of those things, and then start to follow in the footsteps of Christ. And the Bible is there to give us, to lead us and guide us to repentance. So let's read some more attributes and some more characteristics of what we're supposed to be doing, so we can get our minds right with God and with Christ, so we can grow in the Spirit.
Romans 12, verse 1. I beseech you, therefore, brethren.
So we're in the book of Romans, you know, first chapter. Paul is speaking to the people that's in Rome. Go ahead.
I beseech you, therefore, brethren.
I beseech you, brethren. You know, go ahead.
By the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies a living sacrifice.
That we suppose, the ones of us that have, that want to turn to the Most High, that want to turn to the Lord, that are looking, searching, seeking, trying to find answers to what the hell is going on in our lives, what the hell is going on in the world. Go ahead, read on. That you present our bodies a living sacrifice, because Christ became the last sacrifice for the people of God, which are the Israelites, to bring them back to the Heavenly Father. Go ahead.
That you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service.
Go ahead.
And be not conformed to this world.
Well, one of the things that a lot of people, whether they realize it or recognize it or not, is that a lot of us are conformed to the brainwashing of what the society and what the world has to offer us.
Yep.
And when you come to God and you decide that you don't want to be a part of this anymore because this is madness, you know, some of the most controversial topics that you can pluck out, I'll pluck one out, which is homosexuality. Mm-hmm. If you agree with it, you're conformed to the world that you're living in.
Exactly.
That's a problem for a lot of people because they've been brainwashed. The dietary laws, you know, as soon as you go somewhere, you're amongst family and friends, and you say that you serve God, keeping His commandments, you go to a family function, or you hand you some lobster or some shrimps or whatever. I don't eat that, sorry. And you know, they hand you some pork. Oh, I don't eat that. Sorry. And it continues. Sometimes some brothers and sisters that have been practicing that and have been dealing with the transformation into the Spirit of Christ have gone through this. People turn around and say, what the hell do you eat? What is wrong? Look, as long as it's got fins and scales, you know what I'm saying? As long as it's got fins and scales, yep. Part of the dietary laws of the Bible, I'm going to eat it, okay? But I don't eat that. Mm-hmm. And it's amazing to some people when you start to explain the understanding of the scriptures of how we're supposed to follow God. But you have to do what? According to what the scriptures say. And the most important thing, if anything, that you need to do is to listen to what this Bible is saying. So read that part again.
Romans 12 verse 2. And be not conformed to this world.
And be not conformed to this world. Don't be in a... You come to serve the Lord, you cannot be in agreement with what this world has to offer. You cannot be in agreement with the idolatry of this world. You know, the love of money, smoking, drugs, all that stuff. Be not conformed to this world. Go ahead.
It says, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God.
So, coming into the understanding of serving God in Christ, and coming into the understanding of what we're supposed to be doing to serve God in Christ, which is the beginning of Christ's ministry, which is repentance, our minds have to be transformed. Because right now, what's going on in our minds before we pick up that Bible and we make that step to repentance and we make that step towards God and we make that step towards Christ, our minds are corrupt. Mm-hmm. Our minds, what's going on in our minds, the Bible tells you, you know, the heart is desperately wicked and above all things. What's going on in our minds is corruption and evil and wickedness. So we have to get away from that. We have to transform. There's a scripture that says, mortify the deeds of the flesh. If you know where it is, you can grab it. It says, mortify the deeds of the flesh, meaning you have to kill that old man. All part of repentance. Being born again is all part of repentance. It's all part of being transformed. It's all part of you being renewed in your mind by dealing with what the Bible says, dealing with what the scripture says, and putting on that new man, which is in Christ. You got that?
Yeah. Can I just read something real quick?
Yeah, sure. Go ahead.
All right. So I just want to go to the book of Ecclesiastes chapter 1 real quick, because like we're reading, you know, the where Paul is saying, and be not transformed to this world, but be transformed according to the renewing of Christ. I just butchered it, but
we just read
the scripture. And basically, when you take things in context, okay, that book of Romans, Paul was writing a letter to the church that was in Rome. And a lot of people might, you know, they look at these things that they're saying, oh, this is old, you know, it's different now from in Paul's time, so on and so forth. But we had a chance to visit Rome, and we looked at a lot of different historic sites, and it was even pointed out to us where Paul and the other apostles, where they actually came and gave speeches.
This was the first Roman Forum. They call it a Roman Forum. We call it a public square. So when the weather was good, and in Rome we have like 9 months of good weather, everything was here. The very first games, the games were here.
Okay.
The games in Colosseum start in 80 AD. The first games in Rome start at the beginning of the second century before Christ. So the games were here. Marketplace. They delivered the speeches. Everything was here.
Really?
And then when the weather was bad, they used those public buildings.
So the apostles and Paul and them used to come here
to give speeches.
And then they used, when the weather was bad, they used those public buildings. But just to know why they construct
them. How far is Athens from here?
Let's say it depends from which part of Italy. Because from Rome, for example, it's 2.5 hours by plane.
No, I'm just piecing together because, you know, they was doing a lot of traveling.
Not only Athens is nothing, Egypt. Egypt in front of Rome.
Paul and the other apostles, where they actually came and gave speeches, right? And the reason why I'm saying all of this is when we went there, the buildings and the idols and stuff that are set up or that were set up during the time were very big, massive, and very impressive. And people were heavily caught up into idolatry, heavily caught up into fornication, because that's what was being pushed at that time, which are some of the things that are still being pushed right now. So when Paul wrote that letter to the church, he was telling them, hey, don't be caught up into that stuff. Be transformed by the renewing of your mind. So in today's time, it might not be those big, impressive buildings that are set up with all these idols or whatever that sucks people in. It could be the things like Christmas that a lot of people celebrate because it just feels good. It could be things like Thanksgiving that a lot of people are into because it's a good time to be around your family around that time, whatever, and you're looking forward to the meal, so on and so forth. Those things, we have to put those off, because those are all sins, because you're serving idolatry when you practice those holidays. And we have to now be transformed, renewed by the spirit of our minds, and keep the true high holy days that Christ told us to keep. So I just want to read this real quick, just to bring out a quick point here. Ecclesiastes chapter 1, and I'll just start at verse 9. I'll read verse 9 and 10. It says, "The thing that hath been, it is that which shall be, and that which is done is that which shall be done. And there is no new thing under the sun."
Wow.
"Is there anything whereof it may be said, see, this is new?"
Nope.
"It hath been already of old time, which was before us." So the same things that we're looking at today, people getting caught up in the television shows and what's being pushed on TV and stuff like that, they had it back then in Paul's time when he was writing that letter. When we went to Rome and they were explaining about the gladiator games and stuff, we was laughing because the tour guide was like, "Yo, that was like television for like today," because people spent a lot of hours at the Colosseum and they were getting drunk, eating all kinds of unlawful foods, all kinds.
Thank you.
all kinds of stuff. That was their TV for back then because they spent a lot of hours at the Coliseum. Just like today, people spend a lot of hours watching television and getting caught up in all the foolishness that's being pushed, the gay marriage, so on and so forth, the Christmas celebrations, the Thanksgiving, so on and so forth. So there's nothing new under the sun. So when Paul was writing that letter, it still is, it still goes for us today as well, not being caught up into this world, but be transformed by the renewing of our minds. And we can start that by picking up our Bibles and reading it more, which is something that a lot of people lack. They don't read their Bibles, and they're just caught up into the world.
Definitely.
You know, so that was it. You want me to read Colossians? You want to bring something up?
It was mortify the deeds of the flesh, wasn't it?
Right.
Yeah, read that.
Colossians 3, verse 5, it says, mortify therefore your members which are upon the earth, fornication, uncleanness, inordinate affection, evil concupiscence, and covetousness, which is idolatry.
So, some of the things that we have to confess and forsake is right there. Mortify means to kill. So it's talking about characteristics of the characteristics that we possess as men and women in this world that we live in. For you to make that change and stop committing sin, it's letting you know what sin is and the things, the type of sins that is a problem with us. So it says, mortify your members which are upon the earth. Read it again.
Colossians 3, verse 5. Mortify therefore your members which are upon the earth. And just to let people know, the word mortify means to kill, deaden. It's like where that word mortician, where this word comes from. But it says, mortify therefore your members which are upon the earth. Fornication.
So, a man or a woman that is seeking to serve God is looking for something that they know. They, a lot of people say, you know, I've met people and then they say, you know, there's things that I'm doing that I know is wrong. I know I'm not supposed to be doing this. I know I'm not supposed to be doing this. You know, yeah, I'm going out partying, I'm having one night stands and I'm, you know, smoking these drugs and I can feel it. I can feel it within myself. It's wrong, you know? And, you know, you have conversations with people. We have conversations with people like this all the time. I says, well, you know it's wrong. That's why you're saying it. But a lot of time people don't have no guide. The guide is here and it's letting you know. The guide is the Bible. Whether people want to accept it, whether people believe it, whether they want to deal with it or not, the guide is the Bible for you to get your life straight. But what you have to do is follow the guide. So the guide is letting you know how you're going to get back to the Most High in Christ, how you're going to clean yourself up, how you're going to repent, the guidance to repentance. So mortify means to kill, to deaden, to put away. What are you supposed to put away? Read that part.
Mortify therefore your members which are upon the earth.
The members which are upon the earth, meaning you. The members of you. Us. Go ahead, read.
Fornication.
A lot of people are unclear of what fornication is. The Bible explains what fornication is. You have physical fornication and you have spiritual fornication. Don't have time to go into all that right now. Physical fornication goes into adultery. Man sleeping with another man's wife, or man just going out and just having one night stands, you know, all types of uncontrollable sexual lewd acts on a daily basis, not having a care in the world. Same with women as well. Women going out. You have women that go out on the town of a nighttime specifically to commit fornication. How do you know this? Because they're walking around with condoms in their bags. I mean, walking around with a condom in your bag, that means you're premeditating to have some sex with some dude that you don't even know. You just met a couple of hours ago. I meet people like that all the time.
Yeah.
Fornication.
Or you might have some women that they have multiple dudes that they're dealing with. One to pay their bills,
yep.
One to so-called sex them right. You know what I'm saying? And it's just,
yep.
That's fornication too. That's off in the eyes of God. You know, so.
So fornication, go ahead.
Uncleanness.
Uncleanness just goes into all types of uncleanness. Physical hygiene, unclean, spiritual uncleanness, you know, sexual uncleanness. Go ahead.
Inordinate affection.
Same thing, going into the same thing. Inordinate affection. You just constantly, your mind is just constantly on things that's just inappropriate, just not in line with the scriptures, not in line with, you know, a spiritual understanding of how you're supposed to be serving the Most High. Fornication and sexual lewd acts and all types of things. Your mind is just always just not right. Inordinate affection. Go ahead.
Evil concupiscence.
Uncontrollable sexual desire. What, once again, because like the brother read, there's nothing new under the sun. And the same thing that was happening back there in the Roman Empire, the Greco-Roman Empire, is the same things that's happening today. You have all types of lewd sexual parties that people can go to privately mm-hmm. and do what the hell they want to do.
Yep.
Read that again.
It says evil concupiscence and...
Uncontrollable sexual urges and desires. And when you go... One of the places where you see that a lot is in... correct me if I'm wrong, because I know in the States they have it more so than over here, but I mean, not saying they don't have it over here, but is colleges, yeah. Fraternities and universities and colleges.
Yep, yep.
Those kids go crazy.
Yeah.
They go buck wow.
Yep.
Concerning that specific point right there. Yep. Go ahead.
It says, and covetousness.
And covetousness to covet, mm-hmm. which is part of sin, which is part of breaking of the commandments. Covetousness, you know, a lot of people, you want and desire to have something that someone else has that you don't have, and then you do whatever the hell it takes to get that. See a man with a nice house or a man with a nice car or a man with nice clothes or a girl with a nice house, a girl with a nice car, and you become very jealous and envious of that person. You do whatever, you do all types of things just to, as they would say, keep up with the Joneses,
mm-hmm.
being covetous. You know, and it's a spirit. It's a strong spirit and a will and desire to obtain something that you don't have. Yeah, and when we're supposed to be blessed with the things that we have. Go ahead.
Which is idolatry.
Which is idolatry. So that, you know, being covetous is idolatry. Any more on that?
No, that was the last verse.
So go back to the beginning that we left off from. Matthew 4, verse 17.
All right.
The beginning stages of what we're dealing with.
Matthew chapter 4, verse 17.
4, verse 17. The beginning of Christ's ministry. What is it that we're supposed to be doing?
From that time, Jesus began to preach and to say, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand.
So repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. So repentance, go ahead, read on.
That was it for 17.
So to understand and get a better understanding of repentance, we have to know what sin is. So go to 1 John 3 and 4.
Alright. 1 John let's see. Chapter 3. Verse 4. Whosoever committeth sin transgresseth also the law.
So one of the things that we have to understand and we have to recognize is what, for us to repent, we have to understand the sins that we're breaking. And the sins that we're breaking against the Most High in Christ. So the Bible tells us what sin is. We went through a few little characters and a few little specifics concerning some things that we need to change, because it tells you that we have to be conformed. We have to be renewed in our minds. So read that part again.
Whosoever committeth sin transgresseth also the law.
So if you're committing sin, then you're breaking the laws of God. And sin is what?
For sin is the transgression of the law.
So, according to the scripture, sin is the transgression of the laws of God. So some people, they'll say, well, what laws are we talking about? Because you have, believe it or not, you have groups and organizations and people that think or believe that Christ did away with the laws of God. That the laws of God don't exist and we don't have to worry about those laws no more. But a young man came to Christ and asked Christ a question, which is some of the questions that have been posed to brothers and sisters that are serving the Lord, that are keeping the commandments. What can I do, or what am I supposed to do? I'm going to church. I've been to this church and I've been to that church. So go to the question that the young man asked him in John, was it Matthew 18?
Yeah, I believe it is. Hold on.
Go to the question and let's see what Christ said, what we supposed to be doing, how we supposed to be channeling and moving in the direction that we supposed to be going. For sin is a transgression of the law. But what law? What commandment?
All right, it's Matthew 19, starting at verse 16. And behold, one came and said unto him, Good master, what good thing shall I do that I may have eternal life?
So, this Christ is on the scene teaching. He's going out and he started out and he broke down. Look, we have to repent, you know, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. So a young man came up to him and said, look, what do I have to do to inherit eternal life? What have I got to do to be saved, for salvation, however you want to put it? The young, carry on reading.
Matthew 19 and 17, and he said unto him, Why callest thou me good? There is none good but one, that is God. But if thou wilt enter into life, keep the commandments.
So, Christ answered the young man's question. And he said to the young man, if you want to live, you want to enter into life, you want to live forever, you want to serve God, keep the commandments. Which is the law, which we just read in 1 John 3 and 4. Whosoever committeth sin, you're transgressing the law, you're breaking the laws of God. So this is a very good question, and it's a very good question that people ask. Well, what am I supposed to do? Here is your answer. Christ is giving you the answer. Whether we accept the answer or not, that's on each and every individual, because the Bible speaks about a specific group of people who God chose to be His people, and He gave them His commandments to do and to keep and to teach all the other nations. Mm-hmm. But it also speaks to us individually. So it's a collective book for a nation of people, but it's also a personal book for each and every single one of us as individuals to get ourselves right with God, with the help of others that are doing right by God. Mm-hmm. So the young man asked him a very good question. What questions are we asking? Or are we trying to sidestep because of our lust? Are we trying to wangle our way into the kingdom? Because you have many organizations and groups with many different ways they say that you can get to God. But there is really only one way. And Christ is explaining it to the young man right here. Read it again.
Matthew 19, verse 17, and he said unto him, Why callest thou me good? There is none good but one, that is God. But if thou wilt enter into life, keep the commandments.
So according to the Bible, if any of us want to enter into life, want to serve God, we have to do what? We're going to keep the commandments.
Yep.
Carry on reading.
He saith unto him, Which? Jesus said, Thou shalt do no murder.
So the young man said, hey, you know, keep the commandments. He's like, okay, well, which commandments are you talking about? Go ahead, read on. He said, the first one, he says, thou shalt do no murder. Don't murder. Don't kill. Simple enough. Go ahead.
Thou shalt not commit adultery.
Don't commit adultery. Don't go lusting after another man's wife and go lay down with her. But those two, believe it or not, those two, see, a lot of people miss the point. Because we just read in Romans 12 that we have to be transformed here in the renewing of our mind, correct?
Yep, yep.
And when you, the Bible says, get wisdom, get knowledge, but above all, get understanding. What this young man didn't realize, and what a lot of us don't realize, that Christ was always dealing with the transformation of what's going on here. Because a lot of people will hear that and they'll say to themselves, you know what? I ain't done. I ain't slept with no man's wife, man. Mm-hmm. I'm saying, I ain't. Yeah. Man, if I kill somebody, I'd be locked up.
Yeah.
See, that's why when you read and you study to show yourself approved unto God, you get a better understanding of where Christ is coming from. And what a lot of us don't even realize is Christ is dealing with the mind. Because for you to murder your brother, if you know, get that scripture, he that hateth his brother in his heart is a murderer. It's somewhere.
Matthew 5 and...
He that hateth his brother is a murderer. I don't remember where that is. My brain.
Yeah, it's Matthew 5.
You got it?
Hold on. So, Matthew 5, 21, I'll start there.
Just to reiterate on that point concerning the mind and this young man coming to Christ about repenting and the better understanding that we need to obtain to receive salvation. Because a lot of us, like I said, a lot of us will hear that and they'll be thinking about the physical act of murder. You getting a knife and plunging it through someone's heart and they die. But it's deeper than that. It's a lot more to it, which we're going to read. Go ahead.
Matthew 5 and 21. Ye have heard that it was said by them of old time.
Ye have heard by them, which has been said of old time, meaning the Old Testament. So you have in the Old Testament, thou shalt do no murder. Go ahead.
Thou shalt not kill.
Thou shalt not kill. Part of the Ten Commandments. Go ahead.
And whosoever shall kill shall be in danger of the judgment.
And whosoever shall kill shall be in danger of the judgment. The judgment back there, they was, you know, they were the murderer was put to death. They got caught, they got found out under two or three witnesses, then they would die. That was the judgment. Go ahead.
But I say unto you that whosoever is angry with his brother without a cause.
Now, read that part again.
But I say unto you that whosoever is angry with his brother without a cause.
But Christ said, look, in the Old Testament, you had murder. Okay? And if you murdered someone, then you would get judged for it. The judgment is you're going to die. But Christ came on the scene and said, look, listen, I'm telling you this. I say unto you, go ahead, read on.
That whosoever is angry with his brother without a cause
if
shall be...
You're angry with your brother, your fellow Israelite neighbor, without no reason whatsoever. Go ahead.
Shall be in danger of the judgment.
You're going to be in danger of the same judgment as a man taking a knife, walking down the street, and plunging it into another man's chest and killing him. Mm-hmm. Just through what? What's going on right here, mm-hmm, in your mind. This is what needs to be cleaned up. This is filthy. This is dirty. This is disgusting. It needs to be cleaned up. It's got to be swept and garnished. So imagine that. You have a lot of these young men out there running around New York, Chicago, LA, here in the UK, Brixton, Harlesden, wherever. Young black men killing themselves like it's going out of style. Angry all the time. Mm-hmm. Almost every single time I walk past a group of young men, they're always talking about some beef with some other crew or some other guy or something. Just always angry. But the Bible says what? Read that.
But I say unto you that whosoever is angry with his brother without a cause shall be in danger of the judgment.
So just by you having that thought and that hatred and that anger in your mind towards someone for no apparent reason, you have people getting killed over plimsolls, sneakers. You know, you got people getting killed over a look. Don't give a guy a look. What you looking at?
Yeah, that's true.
Yo, I saw you. I know you. I saw you looking at me. And the next minute, beef, fight, bang. You go on YouTube and you see all types of damn people getting knocked out for foolishness. Mm. All that anger and hatred. And believe it or not, we're getting judged for that through death. So don't think that you read and you see specific young men getting killed and that it's the Most High is doing what he's doing. Mm-hmm. A lot of people, that's their judgment. So these are some of the things that we have to recognize and understand and realize how we going to change to serve God and to bring ourselves towards God and get closer to God and Christ. And it all begins right here. Right here, what's going on here. And the only way you're going to clean that up is by what the Bible says. The washing of the water by the word. That's how we're going to clean our minds up. Finish that up.
It says, and whosoever shall say to his brother, Raka, shall be in danger of the council. But whosoever shall say, thou fool, shall be in danger of hellfire.
Is going into cursing out your brother or your sister for no apparent reason. But go back to Matthew's 4:17. Matthew 19.
Matthew 19, verse 17.
Go ahead.
And he said unto him, why callest thou me good? There is none good but one, that is God. But if thou wilt enter into life, keep the commandments. He saith unto him, which Jesus said, thou shalt do no murder.
So just to touch on that point, that's what we went through just a minute ago, is murder. Mm-hmm. Don't think it's just talking about physical killing. It's talking about cleaning your what's going on in your mind. Killing people in your mind, having hatred towards one another. These are some of the things that we need to get rid of before we can even begin to think about repenting and turning to the Most High and dealing with these scriptures. Go ahead.
Thou shalt not commit adultery.
Yet again, adultery. Same thing, dealing with the mind. Christ told you in Matthew's 19.
Same place as Matthew 5. Where we were.
Read that quickly. Same thing, dealing with what's going on here. A man may say, and you notice how Christ picked those two specific commandments?
Yeah. Yep.
Just to let you know, look, you may think that you're doing right, but like the Bible says, study. Seek ye out of the book of the Lord and read. Mm-hmm. You know? Go ahead.
Matthew 5:27. Ye have heard that it was said by them of old time, thou shalt not commit adultery.
The same thing Christ is saying again. In the Old Testament, he told you, the commandment was, don't commit adultery. You know, don't go and lay down with your neighbor's wife. Go ahead.
But I say unto you.
So now Christ is separating the physical from the spiritual, meaning what's going on in your mind. Go ahead. But I say unto you, go ahead.
That whosoever looketh on a woman to lust after her.
If you even have a thought of any form of inordinate affection, concupiscence, which is what we just read in Romans, right?
Colossians.
Colossians. Inordinate affection, concupiscence, which is uncontrollable sexual urges and desire. You're looking at some guy's woman, but it didn't even say a married woman, did it? No. It just says what? What does it say?
But I say unto you that whosoever looketh on a woman to lust after her hath committed adultery with her already in his heart.
It just says, if you look at a woman to lust after her, to play out sexual fantasies in your mind with her, you've already committed the act of adultery. So Christ separated the physical from the spiritual. All begins here in the mind. What you're going to find out is when you're dealing with this Bible and you're dealing with repentance and you're dealing with Christ, what's going to happen is going to make you look at the man in the mirror. That's what it's going to do. It's going to point the finger straight at you or me. Mm-hmm. No one else. Because that's what a lot of groups and organizations and church has been doing for a lot, pointing the finger elsewhere. When you need to point the finger right there. Am I lusting after women in my mind? Am I committing murder in my mind? Go ahead, read on.
But I say unto you that whosoever looketh on a woman to lust after her hath committed adultery with her already in his heart.
Go ahead.
That was it.
That was it?
Yeah.
So jump back to what the young man was asking him. So it was a good question that the young man asked.
Mm-hmm.
And he got the answer.
Yep.
So this is a very good question for anyone who's seeking the Lord to ask. Mm-hmm. And you will get the answer. The answer you're going to get is from Christ. Go ahead.
Matthew 19 and 18. He saith unto him, which Jesus said, thou shalt do no murder. Thou shalt not commit adultery. Thou shalt not steal.
Thou shalt not steal. Stealing. Some of you think taking a paperclip from your job ain't stealing. Go ahead. But it's stealing.
Yep. Thou shalt not bear false witness.
Thou shalt not bear false witness. You know, telling lies on someone. Get yourself out of trouble. You know what I'm saying? Go ahead.
Honor thy father and thy mother, and thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself.
Honor thy father and thy mother, which is what children are supposed to be doing. And not only children, but grown adults as well.
Mm-hmm.
Have much hatred and disrespect for fathers and mothers. You know, just the other day uptown in London, in Mayfair, there was a young man, he's 40, 50 odd years old, killed his father,
because
his father owned a nightclub.
Mm-hmm.
And he found out that his father was only going to leave him a certain amount of royalties of the club if he died. And they had a big argument about who was going to get what. And the young man took a knife and killed his own father over the royalties of the club when he's going to sell the club. Honor thy father and thy mother. Disrespectful.
That's awesome.
Grown man. So yeah. When we hear that, people think about little children.
Yeah.
But what about grown, big adults that's doing wickedness and evil to their parents?
That's true. Yeah.
Honor thy father. And guess what? And that's what, and you see Numbers 15. Mm-hmm. Is it 15:38? The one where he speaks about with promise. It's the only commandment. The only commandment where that commandment was, it came with a promise.
I think that's in the New Testament where Paul had said that. But while we're looking for that, what I was going to say is in that example that you just gave, I mean, that goes right back into what we read in Colossians about mortifying the deeds of the body, because that man, what he just did was he was covetous because he wanted that money or wanted more or whatever, you know what I'm saying? And he coveted after it where it became his idol, the thing that he was focused on. And then that led to, you know, that murder, you know? So it was just funny how, all the scriptures, you know, tie in together. you know?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's just funny how that is. It's Ephesians 6 and 1 and 2.
Hold that 1 second. All right. Let me read the beginning stages of what you're going to read.
Okay.
Because this is very important, because it says, honor thy father and thy mother. And remember, this is the young man. And Christ is breaking it down to this young man what he needs to do to get himself right,
mm-hmm.
for salvation, for eternal life. And he's giving him the commandments. But guess what? All the commandments that Christ is giving this man, it's not just one, it's not what you think it is. So go to, I'll read this first. This is Exodus 20 and 12, which was given to, this was a commandment that was given to the Israelites. It says, honor thy father and thy mother, that thy days may be long upon the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee. So by honoring your father and your mother, guess what? You was going to live long.
Exactly.
That's what the Lord said.
Mm-hmm.
So you look at what's happening today amongst our people, young black men and young black women. Are they not dying? Are they not dying off at a young age?
Yes, they are.
Well, the average age now, from what I understand, the statistics that they always bring out in the U.S. is what, 25 to 30 or something?
Mm-hmm.
They die. All the young men are just dying off 25. They'd be lucky if they make it to 35.
Hmm. And the thing is, too, yeah, right. The Lord told us, he says that a man's days at the most is what, 70. And we know 70 is 20. So that means 70 years old is the normal age that people, you know, should be dying. So we know it's not the norm when we see kids dying from 15, 16 years old. I mean, bro, I went to high school, man, with a lot of kids that I knew that died at 15, 16 years old. Why? Yeah. Because they were dealing drugs.
Yeah.
And they got shot.
Yeah.
That's not normal. So when we see that happening amongst a group of people, that's not normal. That's a judgment that the Lord has pronounced, because the Lord also said that bloody and deceitful men will not live out half their days. So people dying at age 15 and 16, that's what it is. They're catching judgment, mm-hmm. because their hands are bloody and deceitful. They're murderers, amongst other wickedness. And the Lord is not going to let them live out half their days. What would happen if they lived till the 70? More murder, more corruption, more wickedness.
Yeah, because they're not going to give up their lifestyle.
Exactly.
You know?
Exactly.
But that just goes to show you, what are they doing? We're reading it in Matthew. I was just going to finish up this. They're breaking the commandments of God.
Exactly.
The question that the young man asks is, what can I do?
Mm-hmm.
Christ is explaining to him. We're just expounding on it a little bit more concerning what Christ was saying. Because these are the things that we need to do to clean up our minds.
Exactly.
So if we, you can see, according to this one here, the scripture here, you was going to live a long life if you honored your father and your mother.
Yeah.
So Christ said to the young man, honor thy father and thy mother.
Right.
Just bringing back what it is that they were supposed to do back then, up mm-hmm. until now.
Yep.
Which is what we're going to do. Return back to the Most High. Keep his commandments. Mm-hmm. Read that one, what you have.
Ephesians 6, starting at verse 1, it says, children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor thy father and mother, which is the first commandment with promise.
I mean, you don't really need an explanation for that. Mm-hmm. Honor thy father and thy mother, which is the first commandment with promise. You're going to live a long life. That's what the Lord said. We just read two scriptures yeah. concerning the same thing.
No.
So we're going to finish up on this because we're almost done. But let's jump back to the young man. And the question, like I said, if I was to title this show, it would be what? That's the only thing I can think of is what can I do?
Mm-hmm.
That's the title I would give the show. What can I do to serve God?
Mm-hmm.
And the answer is here. Go ahead, read.
Matthew 19 and 19 again, it says, honor thy father and thy mother, and thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself.
And thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. The way how you want to treat, the way how you want to be treated, you have to look at other people and treat them exactly how you want to be treated. Love thy neighbor as thyself. Some people find that very, very difficult to do.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. You know, even the disciples had to ask Christ, mm-hmm. look, you know, about the offenses and stuff. But these are the qualities that we have to possess as young men, as young women, as men and women that are trying to return to the Lord. Forget all that other stuff, man. You know, you have a lot of groups and organizations out there breaking this down and breaking that down and breaking that down and trying to break down. Just break down. Breaking everything down. But we're walking around with all types of hatred towards one another, killing one another. We're walking around with all types of sexual concupiscence and lust, killing yourself. Mm-hmm. So it starts here. Remember that. It starts here. Repentance starts here. And it coincides with the keeping of the commandments, and then you build on that. So I hope that this specific show and this specific topic has brought a little bit of edification and edifying. Lord will, you know, we can continue this another time, you know. So, you know, with that,
brother. We say peace, and any questions, you know, you can call us 1-877-871-1712. Leave your question there, and then someone will call you back, or you can email us at bodyofchrist@ureach, that's letter ureach.com, and, you know, drop us a line there, and with that, we say peace.
Peace.
If you would like to contact us or learn more about the Body of Christ Church, you may do so by calling, emailing, or by visiting our website. Our telephone number is 1-877-871-1712. Our email address is bodyofchrist@ureach.com. UReach is the letter U, followed by the word reach. So that's bodyofchrist@ureach.com. Our website, thebocc.com, contains our telephone number and email address, as well as audio and video biblical lessons and other information geared toward edification in repentance and good works. Again, our website address is thebocc.com. So please feel free to connect with us today.